Tonight's show and topic of discussion do not necessarily reflect the opinion of Spaced Out Radio, SOR Media, or its hosts. Listener discretion is advised. Here at Spaced Out Radio, we are about to take you higher. Broadcasting from the Rocky Mountains of Colorado to you listening around the world, welcome to Spaced Out Saturdays on Spaced Out Radio. You can follow Tessa on our Facebook page at Spaced Out Radio, on Twitter at Tessa TNT, and you can subscribe to her YouTube channel. Go to youtube.com/spacedoutradio for our archives. Now, broadcasting from our Mile High Radio Clubhouse on Spaced Out Saturdays with your host, Tessa Nicole Thomas.
Good evening, space travelers. Secure your tinfoil hats, buckle down tight, and hold on loosely as we soar over the rocky tops of the La Platas on a Rocky Mountain high, get sucked into the vortex of the Four Corners, and settle down snugly at mile marker 419.9 in colorful Colorado. It is Saturday, June 15th, Sunday, June 16th for those of you on the East Coast and beyond, and this is Spaced Out Radio. Hope you guys had a rockin' week, an awesome day, and an even better evening. I'm your host, Tessa TNT, and I'm live tonight broadcasting from beautiful Bayfield, Colorado. We are 150,000 strong nightly on Spaced Out Radio Network, spacedoutradio.com, Spreaker, Paranormal Radio, TalkStream Live, 99.1 FM, WQEE in Noonan, Georgia, home of The Walking Dead, 107.7 UPRN in New Orleans, Louisiana, 93.7 FM, KZFX, TuneIn Radio, 1030 AM, KDUN Radio, as well as Revolution Radio, which you can find at revolutionradio.com. Don't forget to head to our website, spacedoutradio.com, where you can peruse the Spaced Out Radio store and read the encounter online, dealing with everything strange, paranormal, and odd. So tonight I have a treat for all my guys and gals out there. Tonight we are joined by Mr. Robert Rigi. And we've had him on the show before talking about exorcisms, but we're going to be talking about another one this evening, as well as the amazing work he does with children. Robert Rigi is a psychic medium and forensic psychologist. His first experience in the paranormal was when he was 4 years old. He turned 64 last November. Robert has a master's degree in forensic psychology and clinical social work from the University of Florida. He worked as a criminal profiler for the state of Florida for 35 years. Robert has been involved in two exorcisms sanctioned by the Roman Catholic Archdiocese of Chicago. He does many podcasts and radio interviews in the United States as well as the United Kingdom. He does many things within the paranormal field and attends many events in which he has publicly and privately done many readings. He also does readings over the radio, over the phone, as well as in person. Robert is also mentoring 10 children he calls the Children of the Paranormal. These children are so very gifted and talented. His godson is one of these children in whom he is mentoring. He and his family were featured on Dead Files quite a while ago. Robert also volunteers for a hospice and soup kitchen. He primarily ministers to children, and he talks to the children about angels and sings to them. He is able to see and talk to angels and is there to help them assist these children in leaving this earthly dimension for the heavenly dimension. Hey, Robert, welcome back to the show. It's so awesome having you back again.
Thank you, my dear, beautiful Tessa. Thank you so very much. And good evening and good morning to all who are listening tonight and today. And happy Father's Day. Right now it is Father's Day, and my friends in Australia and New Zealand and Philippines and in Guam, happy, happy Father's Day to all of you. And tonight, Tessa, we're going to talk about another exorcism that I was involved in. This exorcism has to do with a female. I can tell you her first name. Her name is Vivian. Vivian is quite a unique, different case. She is diagnosed with schizophrenia. Personalities at the time were fractured. So the question begs is she possessed or is her fractured personality possessed? And that's what we're going to discuss tonight, and what was involved in getting her fractured personality integrated into one. It wasn't easy. It was difficult at best. Last time when I spoke about the exorcism of Kevin, and Kevin is doing wonderfully. He really is, Tessa. And he is getting much, much better. Like I said, he's married now, has a wonderful job. He's in a Bible church. And so he's doing well, but he knows at any given time that he can be repossessed. So he must be very, very careful not get into the Ouija board that he once did, not to get into the booze, not to get into the drugs and those types of things. So I speak to Kevin at least once a month. I see him maybe two or three times a year. And anytime he wants to call me, my telephone is always on for anyone who needs assistance and information. So Kevin is listening at this very moment, I do believe. Okay. I know that Kevin did not listen last time that I was speaking about his exorcism, because there are some things that he will remember and some things that he doesn't. Okay. And so he wasn't really ready yet. And I do believe that he is listening tonight. I told him again to be very, very careful. Okay. But anyhow, he's doing very well. And what I would like to do, Tessa, first, is because I am Roman Catholic, I base my spirituality upon my Roman Catholicism. I do not try to convert anyone to any faith at all. I don't. But for me, my spirituality is based on my Roman Catholicism, which is very precious to me. So what I would like to do is start with the prayer of St. Michael the Archangel, if that is okay.
Sounds great. Great way to protect us from anything that may try to attach. It's funny because when we do shows like this, or even shows with a ghost box, it's important to protect yourself because things do try to attack or attach to some people. So thank you so much for doing that, Robert.
Thank you, Tessa. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, amen. St. Michael the Archangel, defend us in this day and night of spiritual battle. Be our defense against the wickedness and snares of the devil. O thou, O Prince of the Heavenly Host, by the power of God, thrust into hell Satan and all the other evil spirits who prowl the world, seeking the ruin of souls. Amen. Saint Benedict, pray for us. Thank you, Tessa.
Thank you, Robert. And before we get to talking about this exorcism, you're having to run up and down the stairs, hide in the basement and stuff. The weather's like really hitting hard there in Illinois, you were saying.
Oh, yeah. And the tornado sirens went off in the next county, and I could hear them from here. And the weather was just incredible. It just blew up from eastern Iowa. And Peoria is 2 hours east of the Mississippi River. So we get a lot of our storms from Iowa and also from Missouri. But right now it's very calm. But we are under a thunderstorm watch until 2 a.m. Sunday morning. And more storms are coming from Iowa. So at any given time, if the sirens go off, I will, you know, I probably will go downstairs to the lower floor, okay? It's just the fact that 30 years ago, I would have never done that. I would have just stayed on the top floor. You know what I mean? But now as I've gotten older, and seeing the destruction of these tornadoes and such, that I probably will go to the basement. Okay.
Sounds like a plan. Okay.
And there's so many people that I have to do a shout out first, that have been very supportive of me since dealing with, the prostate cancer that I had and chemotherapy. And then on Mother's Day night, I had an emergency appendectomy. But I'd like to do a shout out to Michelle from Lisbon, Ohio. Hi, honey. I know that you're listening. Also to John and Karina and Justice, who are True North Paranormal. They live in Vancouver, British Columbia. Hi, guys. To Lisa and Keith and Steve for Spirit Mechanics. And to all my family and friends who are listening, and to everyone who is listening, all of you are in my prayers. There is a list. I have a litany of people that I pray for, and I pray for your listeners and for you, Tessa. Okay, we all need prayer, and you know this. You know the world right now is so upside down. There's so much evil and so much hate. There is, you know. And it's very, very sad. And again, I believe in the power of prayer because I've seen miracles through the power of prayer. Okay. And, so everyone is in my prayers. So tonight, Tessa and everyone, we're going to be talking about the exorcism of Vivian. And then maybe in the last hour, if we have time, I will talk about, or maybe next time I can come on air and talk about the children that I am with in this hospice. Okay. There are four specific children that that I would like to talk about. Okay, so maybe we can do that another time. Okay?
Okay, and I was thinking if we have time this evening, we could even hit it tonight, but that just depends on how much time we have with the story, okay, because I know it's very intricate.
That is fine. Okay, and it is. And being with these children in the last hours, being with them and their families, it's just incredible. And the angels that these young children see, and the angel, and I see the same angel, and the children will ask me if I see them. And some of them are very scared. Others sing, others cry, others laugh. And so we can go into that later on, okay?
Sounds good.
Okay. So let me take some deep breaths, and we're going to talk about Vivian. Vivian, and as everyone knows, like you said in my bio, that I do have a master's degree in forensic psychology as well as clinical social work. So being a psychic medium and having that experience in psychology works very, very well within the paranormal field. It really does. People have to be very, very careful when they speak to someone, go into someone's home regarding their paranormal experience, okay? I always tell people that it is like an onion, and we have to peel the onion back because it has many layers, right? So we have to get to the core of the situation, because if we don't get to the core of the situation, then you can have anyone in there, any spirit team in there, and they're not going to be able to do anything except possibly tell you, yes, you do have paranormal activity, okay? So it's very, very important, for me it is to look at the psychological side. What was going on at the time when this experience happened? Also, Tessa, and my dear friends who are listening, that we must always validate what the homeowner, what the person is experiencing, okay? We must validate it because it is from their perception, okay? Not our perception at first. It is their perception. It is their experience. And even if a spirit team goes in there and finds nothing, and as you know, that happens a lot, that does not mean that they're not experiencing anything, that the family is not experiencing anything, okay? Spirits don't come out like circus animals, okay? They have all the time in the world because in that dimension, there is no time. No time at all, okay? It's almost like a waiting game, okay? Do I sense them? Of course I do. Do I provoke them? No, I don't. I never provoke any spirit whatsoever. I am very respectful, very, very respectful. And I think that a lot of teams who go into people's homes need to be very respectful of the family who owns the home be respectful of them and also be respectful of the spirits also, if that makes sense. Some people think that I'm crazy when I say that, but
it's very important.
But yes, it is. Jeff, it'd be like me coming into your house and raising all sorts of hell. You know what I mean? And I'm sure that you've heard of horror stories of where spirit groups will go in there and just make a mess of everything, you know? And a lot of the spirit groups they have their own agenda. And we must always remember that we are there for the client and not for us. People must understand that. People must be very mature also. People must be very responsible. People need to be compassionate also, okay? The person that I'm going to be talking tonight is about Vivian. Now, Vivian was a 45-year-old woman. And again, Tessa, when I talk about peeling back the onion, the layers, with Vivian, she was born and reared in a family of Satanists. She was raised with a lot of negativity. She was ritually abused. She was neglected. A lot of things happened to her as a child. So when I met her, she was 45 years old. So just imagine a small child, 4 years old. And you have a 4-year-old child, don't you, Tessa?
Yeah, she actually came in right before we started the show. A 4-year-old and a 6-year-old, they're my 2 youngest.
Okay. Okay, so just imagine your 4-year-old and your 6-year-old being ritually abused. Horrifying. You know what I mean? And when female children are sexually and physically and ritually abused, they deal with it differently than what boy children do, okay? Female children will begin to, their personalities will begin to fracture. I am not being hurt. It is someone else being hurt. And then they will say a name, and then they will have a name for that person, okay? So over the many, many years, she has been abused by her family. Okay, her family now is totally, totally different. But in the early years of Vivian, she went through a lot, terrible, terrible things. And it was just within the last, I would say, 35 years that all of them got out of the dark side, let's say, okay? But she was dealing with so much. And when I received the call about a woman needing help in Southern Illinois, I can say that much. I can't say the name of the town, but in Southern Illinois, and that case was just fascinating, just hearing what her sister was talking about and what I was picking up psychically and such. And hearing this woman scream in the background, that I knew my spirit said, you have to help, Robert, but you have to be very, very careful. I have 2 angels that had been with me way before I was born, a little girl named Angelina, a little baby, and St. Raphael, the archangel. And my angel told me to be very, very safe because it is going to be most difficult and dangerous. And it was. And so I was talking to Vivian's sister, and she was giving me some, you know, the information and such. And I told her that I could not come down in the next several days, but I would be coming down there. Where they lived was like 4 hours from me. And I had to make arrangements and such because I don't like to go by myself. I don't go by myself. I always go with someone. Because you just never know what you're going to be walking into, you know? And so I always have someone go with me. And so So I talked to Vivi. I talked to Vivian's sister for about 2 hours. It went by very, very fast. And then I asked if I could speak to Vivian. And so I did. And I spoke to Vivian, and she was crying. And I said, honey, just take some deep breaths. I am here to help you. Okay? And then all at once, she fractured. And she had been fractured for years before that. Okay? She had been seeing a psychiatrist. Okay? She was on medication, which throws another wrench into the whole situation. When someone's on, psychotropic medication, and if the person truly needs an exorcism, then the question is, you take them off of the medication? Because as we know, if anyone has watched The Exorcism of Emily Rose, which is loosely based on a true story, and again, so we had to be very, very careful. So I told her to take some deep breaths, and then all at once, this guttural voice comes out, and I can't use the word, but this thing, and it was a female voice, different than Vivian, though, totally different than Vivian, said, you cannot help her. Leave her alone. We will help her. And that was one of her many, one of her many personalities. She had four altogether. Okay, there was one dominant one, and again, this, and how I found out about these four different personalities is just talking to her, and then when I did go down to see her, okay, and then I asked to talk to Vivian, and this person, this female, said, "Don't hurt her." I said, "I'm not going to hurt her, but I need to speak to Vivian." And then Vivian comes back on the phone. And you could tell the difference in the fluctuation of their speaking that I was speaking to Vivian, very much so. I wish that I still had the picture that I had taken of Vivian. She gave me permission to take her picture when I was down there. And I took probably maybe 10, 15 pictures of her when she was coming in and out, okay? And her affect, her facial expression changed completely. And I will have to find those. And Tessa, maybe sometime I will send those to you, okay? And so 4 days later, well, after talking to Vivian for a while, I told her that I was going to help her. And she goes, well, I really don't think I really need help. And then all at once she screamed. And so she would go in and out of this, for the next hour or so, okay? So I asked if I could talk to her sister, and Vivian said yes. And so I talked to her sister and told her that I would be down 4 or 5 days later, but to keep in contact with me. And 4 days later, a friend and I, who is a psychologist, went with me. He believes in the paranormal, but he's never had any experiences within the paranormal field. And so anyhow, he went down with me, and we had planned to stay 2 days because I really had to get to know Vivian, okay, and see how many personalities that she had, that she was fractured. So I just needed to know how many, okay. And I know the term that I'm using, fractured, they don't even use that word anymore. But on the other hand, people who are listening to this probably have heard that term before, okay? And so my friend and I went down 4 days later, and like I said, it took about 4.5 hours to get there. Went to a very, very small town, and this town is creepy. Very, very creepy town. It was during the summertime, no children out anywhere, no dogs, no animals, nothing. It was just like going into another dimension. It was horrible. I just felt strange there. You know what I mean? I just felt a lot of negativity, a lot of evil. Mm-hmm. And so it was just, that was overwhelming to me. And again, before we walked up to the door where Vivian lived, said prayers of protection, asking my angel to protect me and my friend, asking God to cover me with his white light of protection, praying to St. Michael to protect all of us. So we go to the door, we knock on the door, and Vivian's sister comes through the door. And this town is very small, like I said, and it's a rural town, and there are you know, farms everywhere, okay? And Vivian was sitting on the sofa, and so she asked if she could hug me, and I said, yes, of course. Which is a bit strange, okay? And again, was Vivian hugging me, or was someone else hugging me, or was it the evil one that was hugging me, okay? But Vivian hugged me, but she whispered in my ear, and it was a different voice than Vivian, you will never be able to help her. Just go home. Leave us alone.
Wow.
Could you imagine, Tessa? That raised the hair on my arms in a heartbeat.
Right.
And go ahead.
No, I was just saying, right. Like, I could totally imagine the hair, not only on my arms, but the back of my neck and wherever else raising up with her saying that. And when you first said that she had told you she didn't need help, automatically I thought that is the dark entity within her saying that. That's not really her, because I'm sure she's inside screaming out, help me, while this other thing is saying, I don't need help.
So then the question begs then, is she possessed, or is it because of her schizophrenia? And that's where the difficulty comes in at. Okay? Is Vivian possessed herself, or is one of her personalities possessed? And how are we going to get her integrated as one? That's most difficult. Okay? And again, do I believe that she was possessed? Yes, I do. Do I believe that she suffered from schizophrenia? Of course I do. Okay, but again, Tessa, and everyone who's listening, to understand about schizophrenia, to understand about that psychosis, to understand about personalities, okay, some may be possessed, while others have no idea what is going on, and that happens, and a lot of people don't understand that. That if a person like Sybil, remember the old show, the movie was, her name was Sybil, Sally Fields played her. Okay, some of her different personalities had no idea about the other ones at all. Okay, and so in this case, some of them did, and some of them did not know what was going on. Okay, and so to get her integrated was not easy. That was very difficult, definitely. And again, I stayed there for 2 days. I did not stay in their home. I felt more comfortable staying in a hotel. And so my friend and I did. And so we spent the first day I was with the family about six to eight hours, just to observe Vivian, to see her going in and out of these different personalities, okay? And the trigger, there's always a trigger object or a word or something that would trigger another personality to come out, okay? Someone lit a cigarette, and so just the sound of that triggered one of the personalities, okay? And so I had to know the different personalities within Vivian, and also the psychologist friend who went with me, taking notes, and he did tape, and that we received permission We received written permission from her family and from Vivian about taping her voice, taping the conversations and such. That is to protect myself and my friend, as well as Vivian and her family, okay? And so I was with her, like I said, 8 hours that day. And so my friend and I went back to the hotel, and so we talked what we observed and how our affect, her facial expression changed, how guttural her voice would be when these different personalities came out. And she did have four different personalities. She did. What makes this most difficult is that one of them was possessed and the others were not. So then what do you do? Okay. When the personality that was possessed by the evil one, when that personality came through, Vivian's affect changed completely. Her eyes would roll up in her head. She would begin to pull her hair. She began to bite herself. Now, if anyone knows about schizophrenia, a lot of people who are schizophrenics, especially paranoid schizophrenics, they will begin biting themselves. They will begin to pull their hair and all sorts of things, okay? And so we determined that one of the personalities was possessed and the others were not. But what we had to do is integrate all of them into one. And that took a long time. We were there for, like I said, 2 days. And the second day, the evil one showed itself in through this different personality. Very, very vile. Very, very, very vile of what this evil one was talking about. And sometimes when this personality, and let me tell you that the name of the personality that was possessed, her name was Anna. Okay, Anna was the one who was possessed. Okay. And so my friend and I would talk to Anna, trying to get the name of the evil one that was, you know, that was possessing Anna. Couldn't get that name to save our lives. There were times though when Anna would come through and she would be very sweet and very nice. Very, very nice. And then the other personalities would come forth and say, don't trust her at all. Don't trust her. Be careful. You know, and when you hear that, in a different, four different voices now, Tessa, okay? And so when you hear that, and granted, I've been in the field for a long time, in the paranormal field as well as the field of psychology, and when you hear those types of things, you know what I mean? And even for a seasoned person like myself, it makes someone just stop and think, you know? It is the most creepiest feeling. You know, and so then the next day talking to Anna, but again, we had to integrate all of her personalities into one. Okay. And so here she has been abused, ritually abused, physically abused, neglected for all those years. And so to get her reintegrated into one. Like I said before, it wasn't going to be easy. So the next day we talked to her family, and Vivian was there. And I said, this is going to take a while. This is going to take some time. Granted, I can take this information that what we have back to the Diocese of Peoria and say, this is what we have. But again, knowing that she was diagnosed with schizophrenia, okay? Like I said, that even makes it more difficult, okay? And so my friend and I were there for 2 days, and we kept in contact with them. I kept in contact with them. Vivian would call me at least once a day, and we would be talking maybe for several hours, and all these other personalities would come forth. Anna would come forth just now and then, but it was just very evil when Anna came through, very, very evil. And so the family knew that we had to get with Vivian, psychiatrist, because she needed to be integrated. She had to be integrated so if the church deemed her truly demon-possessed, that then we could do, and then the priest could do the exorcism, okay? And so, like I said, we were there 2 days. I was given permission to talk to Vivian's psychiatrist. And again, he lived even further away from Vivian because, like I said, Vivian lived in a very, very small town. And so I made an appointment, my friend and I, and my friend's name is Roger. And so Roger and I made an appointment with Vivian's psychiatrist to go talk to him and what we felt and what, you know, and what we observed and such. So 2 weeks later, an appointment with Vivian's psychiatrist. And we went in there and he allowed me to read the record of Vivian for the past 20 years. And what she had been doing. She was very self-abusive. She had begun to cut herself and those types of things. She would do some things also that are even too, I don't want to be real explicit, okay, Tessa, of what she would do to herself physically, sexually, especially when Anna came forward, okay? She would self-abuse herself in her vaginal area, let's say that, okay? Of where she hurt herself several times, and she had to be taken to the hospital. So talking to the psychiatrist, and the psychiatrist is very, very knowledgeable, very, very smart guy. And I said, and I asked him if he believed that one of the personalities was possessed. And he looked at me and said, Robert, off the record, I do. And so I said to him, I truly believe that one of her personalities is truly possessed. But I said that, as you know, we have to get her integrated if the church is going to be doing an exorcism on her. And I said, I realize it's going to take a long time, but I need your help in doing so, that she needs to go into really in-depth therapy, psychotherapy, things like that, those modalities. And I said that this has to be done very, very soon because Vivian is going to end up killing herself. Or she may kill someone else. She may kill someone, okay? And I said, I understand, excuse me. And so I said, I understand that, that you have a small practice here and that we may have to take her to St. Louis, to a psychiatric hospital there. And so he agreed. And then, also, Tessa, I asked about that. Why wasn't she integrated way before this? And he had told me that he had tried to. He tried to do with different modalities and such, but he couldn't do it. And the family did not want her to go to St. Louis. But the family this time gave permission for Vivian to go to St. Louis. And so Vivian's psychiatrist agreed, made the arrangements, made the referral to a clinic, to a hospital in St. Louis. But we had to wait. And so it was like another month before we could get Vivian in there. And like I said, Kevin was just a week or so, and then the church deemed, yes, he was truly possessed. And we went with, I didn't do it, but I assisted the priest in doing the exorcism. So Kevin, altogether, he was in the Chicago area at this monastery for about a week and a half, 2 weeks, okay? And so totally different than it is with Vivian. So during this time that Roger and I were in contact with the psychiatrist, were in contact with the clinic that she was going to be going to, that she was going to be admitted into. I cannot give you the clinic's name, though, unfortunately. I cannot do that because of confidentiality, okay? And so we had to wait a month. And then Roger and I both went with Vivian's family and took her to the psychiatric hospital in St. Louis. And my Monsignor friend here in Peoria Diocese, who knows priests in the St. Louis Diocese and such, gave me a name of an excellent person who knows. He's a young priest that knows about the paranormal. Okay. So I was talking with him and such like that, and I was talking to the Monsignor here. And so we just went from there. And so Vivian was admitted into the psychiatric hospital. And the priest that was involved in this down in St. Louis, he was from the same order as the priest who performed the exorcism on the young boy from the Northeast. That same young boy, the movie of the exorcism, the exorcist was about. This priest was from that same order. He wasn't one of those priests because those priests had already passed away. Okay. And so this priest knew about exorcism, had gone to Rome to be schooled and studied on demonology and exorcisms and such. Okay. And very, very smart man, very, very compassionate man. He met with Vivian several times. And so Roger and I spent 3 weeks down in St. Louis with Vivian. They started her with different medications. Of course, they did a lot of CAT scans and MRIs and a lot of blood work and such like that. And so they started her on different medications, and they went from one medication to another, to different modalities and such, trying to get her integrated, okay, into one. And that took 2.5 months. So now we're into it now almost 4 months, okay? And she's still exhibiting this behavior of what is going inside of her. And other people saw it in the hospital also. But again, people in the psychiatric hospital and the psychiatric nurses and doctors and aides and stuff like that, they know schizophrenia, of course. They know of psychotic behavior and those types of disorders, okay? And with the different modalities they were doing with her, they integrated, after several months, they integrated Vivian. She had four personalities. She had her own, Vivian, right? Then Anna, who was possessed, okay? And then she had two more, okay? So the only personality that was not integrated was Anna. Timmy, the little boy who was inside of her, was there. He was integrated, okay? And also that men or women who have fractured personalities, they can have both male and female personalities, okay? And so there was a little boy, and then there was another little girl. So those two personalities were integrated with Vivian, but still there was one, Anna. Anna is the one that was possessed. Okay? Now, again, is she able to go through an exorcism because she is on medication? So the question begs then, if you take someone off of medication, psychotropic medication, and doing all these different modalities, when those stop and when their medication is stopped, then will they become fractured again? And that's what we had to see. So this priest, like I said, would come and see Vivian every day. Vivian was Christian, not Catholic. And so the priest would pray with Vivian. And that's when Anna came out. Okay? So now Vivian and the two different personalities, they now are integrated in one. Okay? But Anna was the one that was left. Okay? Anna is the personality that was possessed. Okay? And so the priest saw her all the time. The evil one came out at the priest to the point of one time that, well, several times that when we were there, that Vivian had to be physically restrained with soft ties so she wouldn't hurt us or hurt herself, you know? And if she could have gotten at us, she would have hurt us badly. And so several months went further on. She needed help. She needed to get rid of this demon inside of her. She had to save her own life, to save her own spiritual life. And so the priest contacted the Archdiocese of Chicago, Father Michael, I can say his name. And Father Michael and this young priest spoke. And he recommended that, you know, that she have, you know, that she have an exorcism. But the situation is that she is on psychotropic medication and that it is not Vivian who is possessed. It is her last fractured personality that is possessed. And so Father Michael spoke to his colleagues, other priests, different priests that assisted with Kevin's exorcism. Two of them were psychiatrists, other medical doctors and such like that. And so, and then, like I said, Roger and I were down there for a while, and then we left, but still kept in contact with the people, with the young priests there, and then with Father Michael in Chicago area. And so then it was deemed that Father Michael suggested to Vivian's family, we all did a conference call, and also the priest was there from St. Louis, and that she be transferred from St. Louis to the psychiatric area in the hospital of Loyola Medical Center. And Vivian agreed. Vivian's family agreed. And 3 weeks later, so now we're talking months down the road, Tessa, okay? This woman is suffering all this time, you know? But again, we have to be very, very thorough, you know? People just can't be, I mean, God bless our Protestant brothers and sisters who believe they can do a deliverance on anyone who may be possessed. But you know what? They do a lot more harm than they do good because they don't look into the psychological side of it, okay? So the Catholic Church, as well as the psychiatric community, was very, very involved and very in-depth about Vivian's condition and what is going on with her. So now we're getting into 6 months. And then Vivian is finally released, and I am there, Roger's there, Father Michael from Chicago is with us. We're in St. Louis with Vivian's family. Vivian was released to us with Vivian's permission and with the family's permission. Vivian did not go home, that we drove from St. Louis all the way to Chicago. And that's like 6 hours or so. During that time, that we had medication with her. We made sure that she did take her medication. None of us wanted to get hurt. Okay. And I also have to tell you that Vivian's sister came with us. Okay. And that is to protect ourselves, being all men and one woman. Okay. And having Vivian's sister with us, then it also protected Vivian as well as protecting us. Okay. And so we drove to Chicago. She was admitted into the hospital there, into the psychiatric ward or unit. And they began doing more tests and such like that. And seeing how Anna was possessed, that they had to concentrate on that personality and not Vivian, if that makes sense. Okay. Vivian was just the vessel for the evil one. Okay. And so again, it was a very fine line. Some of the psychiatrists there believed that Vivian should just stay on her medication and that an exorcism wouldn't be helpful. It wouldn't be good physically or emotionally for her. Where other psychiatrists who were priests, and some of the psychiatrists who were priests also, like I said, they thought that that would not help. Okay. But others did. And so again, here she is 3 weeks now into that psychiatric hospital or the unit inside Loyola. And so they sent all the information to the archbishop or to the cardinal in Chicago and say, these are our findings. This is what we need to do. This is how they're going to do it. But again, there's a very fine line. Okay, this woman needs help. Should she be left on medication for until the day she dies? Or does she need an exorcism to get the demon out of Anna to where we can integrate Anna with Vivian? And so that was discussed back and forth, back and forth. And again, the church is very, very careful. You know, Tessa, the church doesn't want to go out on a limb, excuse me, a limb and end up hurting someone. Okay. And again, that decision took another month. So now we're going now 7 months from the road. Okay. Finally, the cardinal signed off with stipulations that these stipulations are that, yes, she can have perform an exorcism. The stipulations that within 48 hours of this exorcism has not been a success, and then stop. And then the church can no longer help her. I mean, the church will pray for her and such like that, right? But the exorcism then needs to stop. Because during this time that she will not be on any medication at all. But again, the other three are integrated with her. There is only one that isn't. Now there is that possibility during this Tessa that those other three personalities that are now integrated into one with Vivian at any time those personalities could come back. There's always that possibility. Vivian began to lose weight. She would cry out to help, for us to help her. And then Anna would come through. And Anna was this personality. And how Anna got possessed, how she was the only one that was possessed is that when Vivian began to be sexually, physically, and ritually abused by her own family members within this group, that Anna was a first personality, and during the group, with this ritualistic torture that she went through, is when the demon went inside of her. And that's what her family, and that's what this group of people wanted. Isn't that sick? For a small child. They wanted to see a small child possessed. That is sick. And so Vivian lived through all this. So just imagine, Tessa, everyone, that 4 or 5 year old girl, and she becomes possessed at a very young age. And then they reach out to me, and she's 45. Imagine the torture that she went through.
Yeah, it's got to be terrible. But on that note, I hate to interrupt you, but we do have to go to our first break, Robert. You guys don't go anywhere. Okay. We'll be right back after these messages.
Looking for nighttime adventure? Old school radio that delves into everything out of the norm. Then check us out at Spaced Out Radio. This is Dave Scott. Every Monday through Friday, starting at 9 p.m. Pacific, midnight Eastern, we're going to take you on a wild ride ranging from conspiracies to true crime and every ghost, alien, and Sasquatch story in between. We're always live and we're always interactive with you. So join us at spacedoutradio.com, where together we own the night.
Hey, guess what? You can now get your brand new Spaced Out Radio swag at spacedoutradio.com. We've brought the store back with all new items for you to pick out and pick up for yourself, your family, or friends. T-shirts, hoodies, hats, we got it all. All you have to do is head to our website and click on store. Choose what you want and it's shipped to you. The Spaced Out Radio store is right there for you. Come shop with us at spacedoutradio.com. Then we can own the night together.
So, you love talk radio? Then you'll love TalkStreamLive.com. TalkStream Live is always on 24/7 with the best streaming talk shows. Find your favorite talkers and discover some new ones. It's free, readily available online or on mobile with any smartphone or tablet. Finding your favorite talk shows all in one place has gotten a whole lot easier. Just go to TalkStreamLive.com. Be sure to download the free apps from Google Play or the iTunes App Store.
Canada's largest UFO conference is ready to roll in Toronto this September 21st and 22nd at the Alien Cosmic Expo. This year is about the experience. Listen to the stories of Dave Scott, Travis Walton, Paula Harris, Grant Cameron, Ryan Stacey, Richard Dolan, Leslie Mitchell-Clark, and more. Get your tickets now at aliencosmicexpo.com.
Coming soon to our website, spacedoutradio.com, is the SOR Space Travelers Club. For just $5 a month, you can get into a private area on our site where you can hang with other listeners in our chat room, post in our forum, and check out a bunch of exclusive content and store that won't be found anywhere else, including a nightly after-show party with Dave. It's going to be the best $5 a month you're going to spend. The SOR Space Travelers, only at spacedoutradio.com.
Are you tired of being blocked, shadow banned, or placed in jail for simply posting your thoughts on social media? Social Media Freedom can take care of that for you. Social Media Freedom is the newest and one of the best free new apps that allows you the freedom to post what you want, when you want. It takes seconds to download from your app store. Come join the tribe at Social Media Freedom. It's time to set yourself free.
Visit purpleplates.com today. For over 40 years, the Purple Energy Plates have been delivering amazing results for their many customers. Inspired by the great genius Nikola Tesla, the harmony, healing, and energetic effects of the plates have proven over and over to be beneficial and often miraculous to thousands of customers. Check their site for daily specials and choose from their many energy products. You won't be sorry. Visit them today at purpleplates.com.
If you're heading to Vancouver, make sure you stop by the official bar of Spaced Out Radio, the Moose Vancouver. It's the place to party in YVR. At the corner of Nelson and Granville, the Moose Vancouver is always up to speed with a kitchen staff that serves great food, all food on the menu, $6.95 to $8.95. There's a reason the Moose Vancouver is recognized as one of the hottest spots on the West Coast. Get your horns up for the Moose Vancouver. Come get spooked at the 4th Annual Forest Moon Paracon in Cedar Woolley, Washington, Saturday, September 28th. UFOs, ghosts, aliens, Bigfoot. Speakers include Mike Morin and Jason Jordan, R. Keith Andrews, and Dave Scott from Spaced Out Radio, and so much more. There will be workshops and a VIP roundtable. Get early bird tickets now at fmparacon.com.
A timepiece is a reflection of who you are, and what better way to show off the real you than with an Escape watch? Escape is a lifestyle brand accessorizing your days and nights. Choose to escape and create the life of discovery that you deserve. Dream, play, unite with your own personalized Escape watch. Head to escapewatches.com. There is no time like the present to enjoy your escape. Use promo code SMF2017 for your 20% discount today.
Every night on Spaced Out Radio, we have places for you to hang out. Hi, this is Carl. Join our SOR Space Travelers group on Facebook for live chat. On Twitter, using hashtag Spaced Out Radio, you can also join us in our Spreaker chat room. Check us out on Instagram at Dave Scott SOR. All of our archives are free on YouTube at Spaced Out Radio. By the way, I'll be watching you at your window until you do. Bye!
Hello, this is your guitar man, Ron Bumblefoot Thaw, and I have to tell you, I love the response I get for Little Brother is Watching from Spaced Out Radio fans. It's amazing how music can inspire and make people think deeper about what's going on in the supernatural world. You can head over to my website, bumblefoot.com, to check out my music, my guitar workshops, my touring, even check out some of the hot sauces that I'm working on. And make sure you keep on listening, because with Spaced Out Radio, you know Little Brother is Watching.
Looking for a place to advertise at a very reasonable cost? Look no further than Spaced Out Radio. SpacedOutRadio.com has an advertising tab that you can click to check out our daily, weekly, and monthly packages to play on the radio, or our website, including social media. From commercial spots to banners, we have it all. Check out our competitive pricing today.
You can follow Tessa on Twitter at TessaTNT, on our YouTube channel, Spaced Out Radio, and our website is spacedoutradio.com. Now, back to Spaced Out Weekend host, Tessa Nicole Thomas.
Here's a sound again, boy says, dancing in my head, smile.
All right, welcome back, everyone. Thanks so much for joining us tonight. Tonight, we are joined by Robert Rigi, and we're talking about The Exorcism of Vivian. And if you do have questions, please make sure that you put them in caps. That way I don't miss it, because Robert is more than willing to take your questions. Welcome back, Robert. So great to have you.
Thank you so very much. And yes, if anyone, I know people have a lot of questions they want to ask me, and that is fine. Okay, there are some things that I can talk about, and some things I'm not able to talk about because of confidentiality. Okay, but I know a lot of people are interested in any exorcism. Okay, and so I'd be happy to entertain any of those questions. Okay.
Tonight on Periscope was asking, "Are you a holy man?"
I'm a spiritual man. I'm very spiritual. What I would say, am I holy? We all fall short of the glory of God, okay? And so I would say that I'm a very spiritual person. I believe in the power of prayer. I believe that through the power of prayer that one can be healed. I've seen that. I've seen miracles, okay? I would not consider myself, other people have asked me that too, I would not consider myself a holy man. I would consider myself a very, very spiritual man.
Awesome. And when I find more questions, I'll definitely get back to you with those.
Okay.
But yeah, so we had left off with Vivian. Yeah, go ahead.
Yes, Vivian now is at Loyola Psychiatric Unit in Chicago. She has another group of psychiatrists, psychologists. A lot of them are Jesuit priests. There are some Catholic nuns there. There are psychiatrists there who are not Catholic whatsoever, okay? And so all of them are interviewing her, talking with her. It's not every day that in the psychiatric field or in the field of paranormal that you will get someone whose fractured personality is possessed, okay? And so it's very interesting. I protected Vivian. I did not want Vivian to become a guinea pig. I did not want her to be used and abused by any system. I was very protective, and so was Father Michael, very, very protective of her. During that time, she was on the new medications that they had started down in St. Louis. Those medications continued until the day of the exorcism. And again, the Cardinal, the Archdiocese of Chicago, deemed, yes, that Vivian was just the vessel and that Anna, her fractured personality, was the one that was possessed. And again, many, many meetings. She was in the psychiatric unit 3 months. So now, from the time that I met Vivian to the time of 3 months into the psychiatric hospital, this is going now almost a year, okay? But this woman, this good friend, Vivian, was now seeing the light at the end of her tunnel, but she had a ways to go, okay?
Uh-huh. And before we get any further, Tripp was asking, what do you think about the parents injuring, torturing, even killing their children, thinking they were possessed, trying to perform exorcisms? Do you have any medical or psychological background?
And you know, that we have heard, I have read studies, cases of where a child was going through an exorcism and they end up dying, okay? And that's unfortunate, very, very unfortunate. And again, one must always go through the many, many days, weeks, months of psychiatric evaluation, okay? And so I've heard of those cases here in the United States as well as from Europe, that children have died through these exorcisms. And so the question begs, are these children psychiatrically ill or are they truly possessed? Because there's a lot of psychiatric illnesses that will mimic someone being possessed. It's just like this case that I remember, as you brought it up, is that this young girl, and happened in Louisiana, and I think it was in the 60s, and she had Tourette's disease. Tourette's syndrome, okay? And Tourette's syndrome, you could be talking to the person who has Tourette's syndrome, and there's different levels of Tourette's syndrome also, okay? There's different levels. There's very severe, it's very mild. Well, this young lady had a horrible, horrible case of Tourette's syndrome. And you would be talking to her, and all at once, her whole affect, her whole facial expression changed. Her neck became thick. She started to come out with these most horrible, vile, things, you know, things coming out of her mouth of what she wanted to do to people, what she wanted to do to herself. She cursed, she cussed, and did all sorts of things. And then within 2 minutes, and then she was okay. Now, I think a lot of times when children that were never diagnosed being possibly having Tourette or having some type of mental disorder, that through exorcism, that ministers performed, that a lot of them unfortunately did die. And that's very, very unfortunate, very unfortunate. You know, dealing with exorcisms and psychiatric illness, it's nothing to mess with. It's nothing to make light of. It is very, very serious and very, very dangerous. Very, very dangerous.
Someone was asking, how old was Vivian when this all began?
Of her exorcism, or this happened when she was 4 years old? This abuse, the abuse, and her personality, what we surmise is that her personality began to change while she was 4 and 5 years old. Because her family had related to us that they saw different things within Vivian, okay? They observed her. She would sometimes talk in third person, fourth person, okay? Vivian would talk to herself, but in different voices, if that makes sense, okay? And so this happened. So this poor woman, at 4 years old, she was sexually, ritually, physically, spiritually abused. She fractured very, very fast to protect herself. When a person is so physically and spiritually and physically, sexually abused, is that we need to protect ourselves, right? So then what we do is that I am not being abused, it's someone else. And when the personality, that's when our personality fractures. I'm not being abused, it's someone else. And then that personality then will become fractured. Okay? And so this poor woman had been living with this. Granted, did her family take her to a psychologist? Well, the school did. The school noticed that there was something not right with Vivian, okay? She never had bruises, nothing like that when she went to school during the school year, but during the summertime, the family has related to myself and to Roger and to Father Michael that, yes, that she was beaten a lot, very beaten, during this ritualistic crap that she went through, okay? And so Vivian went through a lot all those years. And people tried to help her. I know that they had said that they had gone to a Pentecostal church. Okay. And they thought that she was possessed. They wanted to do some things, but the family refused. Okay. And praise God that they did. Because that would have just added another layer of what she had, that she would have to go through, okay? And again, my brothers and sisters who are listening to this, that psychiatric illness and or demon possession is nothing to mess with. It is very, very serious, very serious. And so the Catholic Church takes it very, very seriously. And in Vivian's case, they understood that it was the most serious case that they have ever seen of somebody who had fractured personalities, and only one of those was possessed. And so it was, you know, and until it was most difficult. Okay. And so then Vivian is still on the same medication and the same modalities and such like that. And she was beginning to gain weight a bit. I spent a lot of time up there. Roger had to come back here to Peoria, but I spent a lot of time with Vivian. In fact, I stayed at the rectory of the Jesuit priest there. And so I stayed with her. And again, being a Catholic hospital or just a public hospital, I never wanted her to be used and abused, okay? And a lot of people would have done that. You know, they would have done a case study and this and this and that and everything, right? My main concern was Vivian, okay? And that she needed help. And her family reached out to me. Now, during this whole process, that at any time, Vivian could have said, I'm done. Okay? At any given time, her family could have said, we had enough. But they knew that Vivian was fighting for her life. The family took responsibility for what they did to her. So they were living with this guilt. Okay? So getting Vivian 100% better, then that would ease their guilt. Okay? I know that I talked to the family in the most harshest terms of what they had done to her, and really had done to her, and really had done to the entire, into the entire family. Okay? And they understood that. They understood that what they were into wasn't good. They thought first it was just fun, and they got deeper and deeper and deeper into the dark side. And that, you know, Tessa, and that's what happened. That someone kind of dabbles in it. They think it's kind of fun, kind of exciting, okay? And then all month before you know it, they get in so deep. How do you get out?
Tripp was wondering, what does the doctor's religion have to do with someone's psychological disorder?
Oh, no, say that again. I'm sorry, you cut out. Say that again.
What does the doctor's religion have to do with someone's psychological disorder?
Okay, so what we needed is that there are Catholic priests there who are psychiatrists. We also needed a psychiatrist that was not, you know, that wasn't Catholic, or at least wasn't a priest, okay? So we needed both. We needed both sides, okay? So we needed psychiatrists who were priests, yes, also psychiatrists that were Christian and possibly Catholic, but they weren't ordained priests, if that makes sense. And so Father Michael wanted that. Father Michael wanted a combination of both religious psychiatrists, meaning an order like the Jesuits in which he is part of, and also secular psychiatrists, okay? Because all of them needed to be on the same page. All of them did. There was only one man. There was one Catholic psychiatrist, a Catholic priest, okay, and there was a secular psychiatrist. They both had to sign off in doing this exorcism. Granted, the archdiocese already said to, but only with stipulations, and one of the stipulations was that it had to be signed off by one Catholic Jesuit psychiatrist and one secular psychiatrist, if that makes sense, okay? And the secular psychiatrist said yes, and then the psychiatrist, the Jesuit priest, who was also a psychiatrist, also signed off, okay? So I hope that gives So I hope that answers that question.
Awesome. Tonight was asking, do you exercise yourself or are you just an expert in the subject?
Do I exercise myself? I do not have that power from God to do that. And I would not do that. No. I leave it up to the experts that have been trained in demonology, who have done many, many exorcisms. No. Do I assist the priest? Yes, I do. Do I assist the priest in the prayers? Of course I do. Yes, when I'm asked, I do. Yes. But I would not even attempt to. You know, there are some things that I know that I'm not able to do. And so then I refer them to the people who know what to do. And that is and that's just like any spirit group, Tessa. A sign of a good spirit group is that if they are over their head, okay, they will refer them to someone else. Okay? That is a sign of a good spirit group.
Yeah, that's how we do ours. We don't even mess with that stuff. We send it on to the professionals.
Right. And it's like me and in the caseload that I had for many years, that if I felt that I wasn't reaching this person in my private practice, that then I would refer them to another psychologist or to a psychiatrist. And that is a sign of a good therapist, is that. And a lot of groups, so unfortunately, spirit groups, they won't do that, you know. But there are times that things are just over our heads, over our expertise, okay? And so we do then refer them to other people, okay? So I would not even attempt to do an exorcism on someone. I would never do that, never.
And I know we went over this before, but Kat was wondering, who is Robert the Guest and what are your professions? What have you studied and what are your professions?
Okay, well, I'm retired, okay? And my master's degree is in forensic psychology and clinical social work. And I was a criminal profiler for many, many years besides having my private practice. And being a psychic medium, was like that started when I was 4 years old, was my first experience. And so being a forensic psychologist and being a psychic medium works beautifully together. Beautifully together. And again, if I feel that I'm over my head in anything that I do within the paranormal field, and even into the realm of psychology, that I will refer that person to someone else that I believe that can help them. I'm never going to put that person in a situation to make things worse. And I'm not going to put myself in that situation because it's just not, you know, it's just not good for a psychologist or a social worker or a doctor, in fact. To keep on being with someone, assisting them in therapy and whatever, if they are over their head. It's morally and ethically, it's just not good. It's not right. And so morally and ethically, I have standards that I go by because of my degree, and I'm still licensed in 5 states, that ethically and morally, I have to refer them to other doctors, psychiatrists, and such. That is to protect myself as well as protecting, it's also protecting the client.
Another question here. The award is asking, does ignorance protect you from possession or make you more vulnerable?
And say that again, my dear, because you're cutting out. I'm sorry.
He asks, does ignorance protect you from possession or make you more vulnerable, or one more vulnerable?
I think all of us are vulnerable. I think any time that you work with the evil one, anytime that you are close to evil like that, you're vulnerable, very much so. You have to have a good spiritual root. You have to cover yourself spiritually, you know. And by the grace of God, that I cover myself, deal with the love and protection of God. Do I sometimes, like with Kevin, did I have at one time an inkling thinking that maybe that I would become possessed? Of course. And priests do also. Okay? There's always that possibility. There's always that possibility. But you have to stay on, you have to stay on path. You have to believe in God. You have to believe in what you're doing is correct. We are there for the person. We are not there for ourselves. So I always cover myself. And like tonight, talking about it, is it safe for me to talk about it? I'm covered by the white light of God. I believe in the power of prayer. I believe that St. Michael the Archangel helps us. And so I'm covered with his protection, and all of you are also, okay? And just like that, you know, just like what I said before about Kevin and having the evil one, and I have never met Kevin in my entire life. And for the evil one to come over the phone through Kevin saying, Robert, I know who you are and I know what you've done in your life. And then the evil one began to say, I know that you're adopted. And that is very true. I am adopted. And then the evil one said, I know that you're gay. And yes, that is true. I am gay. I know of the things that you've done growing up. And then the evil one would say this and say that. And that was correct. Now, Kevin would never know those things. Okay? And so, you know, and again, I am protected, but I am well protected. But there's always that possibility, always that possibility. And when the evil one came through Kevin and said to me, Robert, if you don't leave, I won't say the words, but anyhow, if you don't leave Kevin alone, I will come to you and I will hurt you. Did I back down? No, I didn't. Was I scared? Yes. And that's just human nature. If someone said that to you, Tessa, or anyone who's listening, that you would be terrified to hear that and to know that the evil one, granted, Kevin and I lived 4 hours away from each other, but the evil one could have been here in a sec, a half a sec, in a heartbeat. Okay? And so do I protect myself? Yes, I do. As much as what I can, I protect myself. But there is always that possibility. But that's one thing during an exorcism, that you focus. You focus on the person who is going through the exorcism. You focus on the prayers. You do not focus on yourself. When the evil one begins to attack you and say and tell you of the personal things that you have done in your life, you ignore it. But being human, what do we want to do? We want to counteract that. And having dialogue with the evil one, it is not good. That's why that that only one priest. In my experience in reading and looking at the films from the Vatican, that one priest is in charge of the exorcism. There may be other priests there, yes. But one priest is in charge of the exorcism. And we are told all the time is that when we are assisting in an exorcism, and if the evil one starts attacking you, me, that we ignore it. We ignore it. We begin to pray more. We think of something else. Because the evil one will begin to attack. Will begin to attack the people inside of that room. Just not physically, but emotionally and psychologically. Okay?
Okay. And then the ward was asking, what are subtle signs of possession or indicators that one may be becoming possessed?
And again, there's a fine line between possession and mental illness, because there's a lot of mental illnesses that will have the same behaviors as someone who is possessed. And like with Kevin, that the evil one came through him and started to attack me on the phone and say those things. So someone who is psychiatrically ill would not know that I was adopted. Somebody who is psychiatrically ill would not know of my past, would not know of really of anything about me, okay? But the evil one has that power. That's one of the main differences. When the evil one comes through and begins to tell you things that only you know, then you know you're dealing with the evil one and not someone who is psychiatrically ill. Okay?
Char was asking, let me scroll down here a little bit, how does your mediumship affect you during exorcisms?
During that time, because I have learned how to turn it on and off over these many, many years, and that's when I'm mentoring 10 children and teaching them how to turn on and off their gifts and talents from God. So during an exorcism, that I turn my mediumship and I turn the psychic gifts and talents that I have, I turn it completely off. Completely off. Do I still have my angels with me? Of course I do. Do they speak to me? Of course they do. But during the time of exorcism that I'm involved in, that I close the book. And how I open it is, and I teach these young children that to open and close the book. When I am doing a reading with someone, and I will open the book in my mind, and I learned that as a child to do that, that means that I'm open. I am open to the spirit world. And when I am finished, I close the book, not to be disturbed, until I open the book again. So during exorcism, that part, those gifts and talents that I have are closed completely. They're closed completely. And still, I have my angels, like we all have a guardian angel, okay? And so my guardian angels are with me. And I listen to my gut. I listen to my gut. My gut says something to me, and then it's a spirit inside that tells, this is what I need to do next. This is what I need to stay away from, okay? And that's what I do, okay? It is not safe. It is not safe for any psychic medium to be open during the time of exorcism. They leave themselves open. And not a very safe place. They need to have those completely closed during that time.
Okay, and people are making assumptions in the chat room and such. Do you charge for any of this work you do?
I do not charge for anything, Tessa. Nothing.
I didn't think you did.
Did I charge Vivian's family? No, I don't. I didn't. Did I charge Kevin? No, I didn't. Did the church charge Kevin? No, they did not. Did Loyola University Hospital charge Kevin? No, they did not. Did I charge Vivian? No. Did Father Michael? No. Did the priest in St. Louis? No. Did the hospital, Loyola in Chicago, charge Vivian? What they charged Vivian was for the stay in the hospital, not for the exorcism. Not at all. Could you imagine getting a bill? Oh, $1,000 for an exorcism. That was, you know what I mean? I mean, you know.
Right.
I don't want to make light of that, but could you imagine getting a bill? Oh, $12,000 for exorcism. But anyhow, I don't want to make light. But anyhow, no, I don't charge for anything that I do. If someone wants to give me something, that's fine, but it's up to them. If they don't want to give me anything, that's fine. You know, there's so many psychic mediums out there, and bless their souls. I know people have bills. I have bills also, okay? But when a psychic medium or a spirit group says, well, it's going to be $500, I tell other people who have come to me, then just truly hang up the phone. You know what I mean? You know? And so I, you know, because I believe my gifts and talents are from God. But if someone wants to give me something financially or physically, that is up to them. You know, Vivian's family was very, very poor, Tessa. They were dirt poor. Very, very poor. And Kevin at the time, I mean, Kevin was, you know, making ends meet and such like that. But he was no millionaire by no means. Okay? But again, if someone wants to give me something, it is up to them. I don't charge at all. I know it's probably hard that people think, oh my gosh, because a lot of psychic mediums, I mean, I see people on Facebook, psychic mediums on Facebook, you know, they have, and which drives me crazy is that they will have the same client once a week. And they've been having him for years. That makes no sense to me. Not at all. That doesn't.
And Danny's like, then why do it? But we also, all the work that we do for people on paranormal investigations, and whether it's your home, your business, or whatnot, we don't charge for that. If we did, we feel like we're taking advantage, because there really isn't a lot of help for that out there, and people actually treat them like they're whack jobs. We do it out of the kindness of our heart and to help people, and actually pay a lot of money for our equipment and different things that we use for cleansings. Like, a lot of people just do this because we're all put here for a different reason, and that's to help people, and that's all you really need, you know?
Right, and it's very, very true. And, you know, as you know, Tessa, that I'm sure that you have gone, and that people have contacted you and your group, you know, stating, well, we've had these other groups come in, and they charge me this, and they charge me that, and I'm sure that you've heard that. And I'm sure that you've also heard that a lot of groups have just left clients hanging. And here they are, they've made things a lot worse. And I hear that all the time. And so by the time somebody gets to me, contacts me, then they have gone through three or four different groups. And they find out about me, they contact me to see if I can help them. I do what I can. I will meet with them if they're in the area. I will talk to them on the phone. We will do FaceTime and those types of things. Okay? But again, I mean, there are so many people out there that charge just horrible amounts of money, you know? And that's just not right. Because again, I believe my gifts and talents, that they come from God. And to abuse those gifts and talents, and that's why I'm mentoring these 10 children, so they can use their gifts and talents appropriately, you know? And so I tell them, I tell these young children and their families, I said, never charge anyone for your gifts and talents. You do that because they are gifts and talents from God, and they should never be abused. If someone wants to give you something, that's fine. But if they don't, and that is fine also, okay? And I'm sure, Tessa, I'm sure that somewhere along the line that people have offered you some things in your group, haven't they?
It was one of the last cases we did, and we sold them a cleansing kit, and they purchased another cleansing kit for someone who may need it that can't afford it. So we do different things like that, like sell cleansing kits in order to make some sort of money to pay for our stuff. We also have each member of our crew pay dues, and that has... Yeah, and that way we have money for our websites and our phones and whatever else, but we don't charge... And we never suggest to them to donate. If they want to, they can. And so that was really awesome when this family decided to not only buy one for their daughter, but to buy one for someone else who may need it. And shortly after, somebody popped up who did. So that was really awesome. But we never expect any sort of payment. And we're always happy with our jobs and what we're doing. Of course, we have regular jobs, but, you know, we do this in our off time.
Right. And, you know, with me also, it's like, you know, granted, I am retired. I am on a fixed income. And again, a lot of times that's the first thing that people will ask. How much do you charge? And like I said, I charge nothing. And they said, really? I mean, you know, I mean, that, you know, that's really hard for them to believe, you know, but I don't charge them anything. But then I said, well, if you want to give me something later on or whenever, that is fine. And if you don't, that's fine too, you know? So I really leave it up to the individual, you know, and I do. And sometimes they do, and sometimes they don't, and that's fine. I do just as much work as I do if someone's going to give me a gas card or whatever, okay? Having money or not having money doesn't determine what I'm going to be doing for them at all. Money has nothing to do with it at all, you know?
Someone in Periscope is asking for your number so they can give it to other people. Is that okay to do? Or you're retired, yes. Or how does that work?
Okay, yes, very much so. Please, if anyone needs assistance or information, please call me 309-213-0325. I live in Peoria, Illinois, in the Central Time Zone. Peoria is 150 miles southwest of Chicago. I get calls from all over the United States. And again, my number is 309-213-0325. If you have any questions, if you need information, or if you just want to talk, I am here to help anyone. My phone is on 24/7. There is one day a week that I take for myself, a day of meditation and reflection, a day of prayer. But again, my phone is always on. I never will turn anyone down. People can text me and I will get back to them. In fact, this past week, I received 3 different texts. 2 from California and 1 from Maine, wanting some information to see if I could help them or if I could refer them to someone in that area. Okay. And, so I am here to help in any way that I can, because I truly believe that my gifts and talents are from God, and I will never abuse those gifts and talents. Never. Never will I do that. That would be, to me, a sin, a great sin, to abuse the gifts and talents that I have.
And a lot of times, so again, when people do so, they lose their gifts, from what I've seen. So.
Yes, and that is very, very correct, Tessa. There are some times where people, they abuse and use other people just to gain a dollar. You know what I mean? And eventually, I believe in karma, and I believe that will come back and bite them in the butt somewhere along the line, you know? And so I try to do my best with every client. I don't even call them clients. I call them my friends, okay? And a lot of them have become like family members to me. It's just like my friend who lives in Ohio, Michelle. And I know she's listening. And Michelle and I, she heard me on another on a podcast called TouchedByHeaven.net, and I was talking about my experiences working with children and their transitioning from this earthly dimension to the heavenly dimension. And Michelle was having a most difficult time in the grieving process. She had been taking care of her son, who was in a horrible diving accident. And she was having, and she took care of him until God called him home. And Michelle was having such a difficult time. And I believe, Tessa, that God puts us where we need to be at any given time to help those in need. And Michelle, and I know she's listening, that she has come such a long way from the time that we began to speak on the phone to the time now. She has come such a long way. So I took her hand, like I've taken many other hands, and I go on this grieving journey with them so they are not by themselves. Okay. And Michelle is such a great, beautiful Italian woman, great family. In fact, I am going to Ohio to see Michelle and her family. She's invited me to come there. So from July 14th until the 24th of July, I will be in Ohio with Michelle and her family. And I'm so looking forward to that. And again, Tessa and everyone who is listening, is that when people call me, that a lot of us, they're like family, okay? And so I am there to help them, like Tracy in California and Melissa in Utah and Bobby who lives in Idaho. They heard me on different programs and they reached out to me. And so we're like family. And they know that my phone is on 24/7. They know that I am here sometimes just to listen. Because a lot of times that's what that we need. Just someone to listen to us. Not to say anything.
So true.
You know? And so a lot of times people want to, you know, they want to give their advice and God bless them for that. But a lot of times people just need to vent. They're not able to do it to their family members. They're not able to do it to their spouse, and I understand that. And so I allow them to. They can rant and rave. They can scream. Fine, get it out, okay? That's what I'm here for. So again, if someone needs information or needs my assistance, please call me. 309-213-0325.
Char was wondering, have you ever seen demons cause split personalities?
Have I ever seen demons cause split personalities? Is that what you're asking?
Yes, that's what Char was wondering.
Okay. I don't have any experience with that. No, I don't. I'm trying to figure that out. A demon causing someone to fracture their personality. No, in my experience, I have not experienced that at all. I'm not saying that it doesn't happen and it could. There is a possibility with anything. And with Vivian, it is very, very rare, that here she is fractured with these different personalities. Three of them now are integrated. Two of them are integrated with her. One of them remains not integrated, and that is the one that is possessed. So in my experience, and this is something going weird in my room. And a lot of times, Tessa and everyone, when we begin to talk about the evil one, I will experience some things, okay? And that's what I'm experiencing now. And I pray that you folks aren't aren't experiencing anything. Okay? Am I protected? Yes, I am. But I hear ticking and knocking. Okay? I try to ignore that, but my spirit has urged me to say that because there is always that possibility. Okay? That, okay? But again, so again, when Vivian, through her abuse, her most severe, profound abuse, physically, sexually, spiritually, that when she began fracturing, then the evil one, that's how the evil one attached itself to Vivian. And it is Anna that is possessed. It is her fractured personality, Anna, because Anna is the first one that when she began to be brutalized, severely brutalized in every form that you can think of, that when she began, her personality began to fracture, that is when the evil one attached itself to her, to that personality.
Yeah, they're basically just looking for that chink in your armor, whether you're an adult or you're a child. They're looking for that in, and that's all it takes, really.
Yes, and you know, especially because of what, especially what Vivian was going through at that young age, 4 years old. 4 years old, being brutalized physically, sexually, spiritually, being brutalized. My God, you know, Vivian suffered greatly all these years, and I believe, Tessa, that God puts us where we need to be at any given time.
I agree with that.
And Vivian's heard, and Vivian's family heard me on a program. And just like with Kevin, Kevin was down at St. Louis, at the St. Louis Arch. And he was overhearing some people talk about paranormal things and such. And someone had, they were beginning to talk about me. And Kevin just, you know, interrupted in a way and said, I'm interested in who is this person and whatever. Okay. So that's how Kevin got to know who I was. But then it wasn't until months later that Kevin contacted me for help. But again, I believe that God puts us where we need to be at any given time. That is one of my mottos that I will die with. Another motto that I have is that we are all spiritual beings in a physical body.
So true.
I truly believe. Yes, very, very true. Are there any other questions?
Yes, the award in Periscope was asking, is karma any different than religion?
Very much so. Oh, I think it is, yes. Oh, yes, very much so. I think it is. That you do good karma. And a lot of people will go back to the Bible and, you know, do the golden rule, which is karma in itself, okay? But no, I mean, I truly believe for what I believe in karma, is that if you do something good for someone and then it'll come back to you, you may not know it. It may be months, but one must always believe that if you do something for someone and want something in return, then you're doing it for the wrong reason and you will not be blessed. Okay? And so do I believe in karma? Yeah, I do. You know, that we all try to be the best people we can be. Okay. Do I believe it is religion? I don't personally, but in the Bible, the golden rule and such like that. Okay. And again, I think that for me personally, I am more spiritual than religious. Someone said to me that is a lie and that spirituality comes out of religion. And I said, in any religion, it is a spiritual journey. And even not believing in any religion, we are here on a spiritual journey, not a religious journey, but a spiritual one. God created us for some reason. We must find out what that reason is. all of us, this way before we are born, I believe that we are created for a specific reason. We must learn the lesson in life, whatever that lesson is. And if we don't learn the lesson in this lifetime, we will have to live it. We will have to come back until we find out what that lesson is. Do I believe in reincarnation? No, I do not. Not at all. But I believe that our spirit comes back in another physical body. And like with me, that I believe in past life regression. And so I have been regressed. And even prior to that, I have lived four different lives. A life of debauchery, being a senator's son, going to the games, gladiators and all that crap, right? And then also to the time of St. Francis during the 14th and 15th century, being a monk. So I went from a life of debauchery to a life of austerity. And then another life that I had was during the time of like the early 1800s, in the pioneer days. I think that's why I'm so connected with the Colorado Rockies. And I've been to the Appalachian Mountains, and they're beautiful, but there's nothing like the Rocky Mountains.
I know, they're so beautiful. But I hate to cut you off, but we do have to go to our second break. You guys don't go anywhere. We'll be right back after these messages.
Come get spooked at the 4th Annual Forest Moon Paracon in Cedro Woolley, Washington, Saturday, September 28th. UFOs, ghosts, aliens, Bigfoot. Speakers include Mike Morin and Jason Jordan, R. Keith Andrews, and Dave Scott from Spaced Out Radio, and so much more. There will be workshops and a VIP roundtable. Get early bird tickets now at fmparacon.com.
Coming up this September 21st and 22nd, all UFO eyes will be focused on Toronto for the 4th Annual Alien Cosmic Expo. Come listen to some of the biggest names and experiencers in ufology. Travis Walton, Paul Hellyer, Richard Dolan, Paula Harris, Grant Cameron, Randy Kramer, and Spaced Out Radio's own Dave Scott. Tickets are on sale now at aliencosmicexpo.com.
Heading to Vancouver and looking for a night on the town? The Moose Vancouver is the bar that never stops rocking until 2 a.m. every night. The Moose has great food with everything on the menu from $6.95 to $8.95. Fantastic, vibrant staff and rock and roll that will bring you back to when the music was real, the hair was long, and the guitars were rocking. Get your party on at the Moose Vancouver, the official party bar of Spaced Out Radio.
Get your horns up with me on Spaced Out Radio. This is Ron Bumblefoot Thaw. Come tune in to SOR where you can hear me rock out with Little Brother Is Watching, the official theme song of Spaced Out Radio. And then come on over to bumblefoot.com where you can find out about my tour schedule, my music, and everything else. Bumblefoot.com keeps you up to date on what I'm doing and the best way to stay in touch with my music and music camps. Sign up for my newsletter at bumblefoot.com and remember, Little Brother Is Watching.
Come get spooked at the 4th Annual Forest Moon Paracon in Cedar Woolley, Washington, Saturday, September 28th. UFOs, ghosts, aliens, Bigfoot. Speakers include Mike Morin and Jason Jordan, R. Keith Andrews, and Dave Scott from Spaced Out Radio, and so much more. There will be workshops and a VIP roundtable. Get early bird tickets now at fmparacon.com.
You hear footsteps in the empty room above you. A rocking chair begins rocking by itself. Don't be afraid of the things that go bump in the night. Reach for Spirit Story Box, the iPhone app the Huffington Post UK called the only ghost hunting app you will ever need. Spirit Story Box. The spirits are telling their stories. Are you listening?
Hi there, this is Geraldina Roscoe from San Francisco's Bay Area Meditation. I invite you to join me the first Tuesday of every month with Dave Scott for Spaced Out Radio's The Spiritual You. In this fast-paced world we live in, it's time for you to take some time for you. We'll cover every possible subject from powerful meditation to healing techniques to your own intuition and spirituality. So come join us for The Spiritual You.
The freedom to post what you want, when you want. That's the social media freedom you need. Social Media Freedom is the free app in your app store. No need to worry about going to jail or being shadow banned any longer. It's the freedom to say what you feel. The freedom to know Big Brother isn't watching. It's the way social media is supposed to be. Social Media Freedom. It's time to set yourself free. Download from your app store today.
Come hang out with Spaced Out Radio, where we own the night. This is Carl. You can follow Dave on Twitter at Spaced Out Radio, and during the show, use the hashtag Spaced Out Radio to chat with us live. On Instagram, at Dave Scott SOR. On Facebook, give our page a like, Spaced Out Radio Show. SOR archives are free on YouTube at Spaced Out Radio. Come join us, or I will come join you. See you at your window.
Are you intrigued by paranormal talk radio? You'll love the new Paranormal Radio app from TalkStream Live. You'll find a great selection of talk shows covering UFOs, ghosts, strange phenomena, and much more. Download the Paranormal Radio app now and start listening to the very best in paranormal talk entertainment, including the network you're listening to right now. The Paranormal Radio app, free in Google Play and the iOS App Store.
We are getting ready to relaunch the SOR Space Travelers Club at spacedoutradio.com. For $5 a month, you can join us for a plethora of features found nowhere else. Hang out in a private chat room during the show and after party. You can check out some exclusive content and a store specifically for you, as well as a private listener forum where you can post your thoughts, stories, and pictures. The SOR Space Travelers Club, coming soon to spacedoutradio.com.
Find your escape where time has no limits. It's about living today and cherishing the heritage of yesterday. A spirit of adventure for what is new, with the nostalgia of the past. Your timepiece is a reflection of who you are. Life surrounded by beauty from the world around us to the soul within. EscapeWatches.com. There is no time like the present to enjoy your escape. Use promo code SMF2017 for your 20% discount today.
Are you interested in advertising on Spaced Out Radio? Head to our website at spacedoutradio.com and click on our advertising tab. There, you will find an assortment of ways you can get your product out there with us, from radio commercials to banners and social media. Have a product you like our hosts to endorse? We can do that too. Visit spacedoutradio.com for more details.
Hi there, this is Dave Scott from Spaced Out Radio, and I want you to come on a nightly journey. Starting at 9 p.m. Pacific, midnight Eastern, every Monday through Friday, you can come hang out with me and the other space travelers. We have it all, from Carl the Alien bouncing on by to those misfit gnomes causing havoc. It's 3 hours of fun and entertainment on those topics the mainstream really doesn't want to touch. Come get all paranormal with us at spacedoutradio.com. And together, my friends, along with our resident guitar god Bumblefoot, we own the night.
Sit back, relax, grab a drink, and listen closely. Spaced Out Radio continues through the weekend. From the mile-high mountains of Colorado to you, listening around the world, this is Spaced Out Weekend with Tessa Nicole Thomas.
Wow! All right, you guys, we're back. And we're joined by Robert Rigi. Robert, welcome back to the show. Thanks so much for being on tonight.
Thank you, Tessa, and thank you for allowing me to be on air with you. It's such a pleasure. It truly is. I am so blessed in knowing you, my dear friend. And thank you, everyone, for listening. And again, if you have questions, information that you need, my number is 309-213-0325. Also, you can go to my Facebook page. I am getting a new website, started and such. But if you want to go to my Facebook page, you will see a little boy, not my picture, but you will see a little boy, my profile picture. And that is one of the little angels who I assisted in transitioning from this earthly dimension to the heavenly dimension, a very, very special angel to me. And so if you want to friend me on Facebook, please do. Okay? And so, Tessa, we're going to, do you have any other questions at this moment that you want to ask me?
We have a few more. And I'm trying to just take one question from everybody right now because I do want to finish the story. One is from Nikki, and she said, you mentioned Archangel Michael as protection, but what do you do for protection besides angels and guides? Do you use sage, do meditation, ground, center, use gemstones, wear specific blessed items, etc.?
I do not use sage. I have never saged my home. I don't use incense either. Have I used sage in house blessings? Yes, I have. And people must be very, very, very careful in saging their home. If they don't know what they're doing, it can just make things go off the chain a lot worse. So please be very, very careful in doing that. I meditate. I pray a lot. I have my angels to protect me. God protects me. Do I believe in the Trinity, the Father, Son, Holy Spirit? Yes, I do. And so that's how I protect myself. And like I said, I have one day a week. I'm not going to say what day it is because my phone is always on. That is the day where real deep meditation and reflection and what I need to do, just not for other people, but for myself. And that's one thing happens to a lot of psychic mediums, that we don't take time for ourselves. And I know that personally, that is very true because I know that God has wanted me just to take care of myself and do things for me. And yet I am here to assist other people. And I know that God understands that. And yet I have had some physical problems. So it's almost like, okay, Robert, if you're not going to do it on your own, then do I believe that God causes cancer and those types of things? No, not at all. I'm not saying that. But with my emergency appendectomy on Mother's Day, that has curtailed some of the things that I do. Not a lot of them. I know a lot of people are on me to take it easy and don't do this and don't do that. But you can watch, and I can only watch I Love Lucy and the Honeymooners just so many hours of the day. You know what I mean? And I have to keep going, you know, and doing what I need to do for myself and for other people. You know, for a long time, I put myself on the back burner, always there for someone else. And then I realized that if I want to continue helping people, I have to think of myself, not in a selfish way, not in a vain way, but I need to do things for myself. And I know going to Ohio and being with my friend Michelle and her family, it's going to be very restful. I know that I will be meeting with her family and doing some things, but just being with them. And I am so looking forward to that.
And it's amazing how we create our own families, and it is important to take that time for yourself. And I had to learn that as well. You got to take time for yourself, because if you don't help yourself, you can't really help anybody else. So good for you being aware of that.
Yes, and that took a long time for me to understand that. And so I love myself, not in a vain way. I love myself more today than I did yesterday. And yesterday I loved myself more than I did 20 years ago.
Well, we actually have a caller from an unknown number. Who are we talking to?
Hello. I just wanted to get your opinion on the changing brand of angels. Angels over the years seemed almost clunky, but now there seems to be a new awakening, a new branding of the angel. which makes it cooler kind of be on the side of the light versus on the side of the dark. And I just wanted you to comment on that. Thank you.
Yes, that is very true. Within the past, I would say 30 years, that angels have become more important to us. We are all told if you're Catholic and go to Catholic schools, or if you go to Sunday school, if you're Protestant, or go to a Christian school, that yes, that we are told about angels. I was told about angels early on, that we all have a guardian angel. But about 30 years ago, angels became, everyone was writing a book about angels, okay? And angels are very, very important to us, very much so. They are there to help us. They are there to protect us. Someone asked me, how do I know that their angel's name? And at times that I do, and what I tell folks to do is to talk to your angel. Ask your angel what their name is. And the first name that comes to your heart, that is the name of your angel. Your angel will help you, especially when you ask your angel to help you. Okay? And so the angels are around us 24/7. There are some angels that walk the earth without wings. Okay? Mm-hmm. There are some instances in our lives that someone will come up to us and we think it's a homeless person, a bag lady, a bag man. Okay? That could be an angel. Okay? And so always acknowledge someone coming to us. If it is just hello, take a moment and talk to them because it could be an angel. And in my lifetime, I have met many angels walking this earth with no wings. And maybe I'm sorry?
Oh, I was just listening to you. Yeah, that was great. My question, and my final question I'll hang up. Have you ever known of an angel to lose a battle?
To do what, sir? You're cutting out. I didn't hear the last part.
I'm sorry. Have you ever known an angel to lose a battle against demons? That's my final question, and I'll hang up and listen. Thank you.
Okay. Tessa, can you repeat what he asked?
He asked if you have ever known of an angel to lose a battle with demons.
Oh, to win a battle with demons?
To lose a battle with demons.
To lose a battle. I'm sorry. No, I have never experienced that in my life. Never. Never. If it's truly St. Michael the Archangel, who is the protector, Gabriel the Archangel is the announcer, and Raphael is God's medicine of love to us. I have never known of St. Michael ever losing to the devil. Never. I've never known of any angelic being losing to the devil. Never.
Awesome. Julian was wondering, did you see any shape-shifting while assisting the exorcism?
I have seen different things. I have seen dark shadows. Not the show when I was a little kid, which I loved, but dark shadows in a room. I will continue with the story of Tessa. Excuse me, not Tessa. I'm so sorry, Tessa. Of Vivian, okay?
Oh, no worries.
Okay, and I will describe what I personally experienced inside that room. Okay?
Sounds good.
Okay. So Vivian now, so we are at Viola Medical Center, the psychiatric unit. Now, she has been on psychotropic medication for many, many years, and she was just changed to new medication. And it is not safe for anyone who is listening, who is on any type of medication, they should just not stop cold turkey. Please go to your doctor, go to your medical doctor, go to psychiatrist, and have them begin to wean you off of that particular medication. No one should ever go cold turkey, especially if a person who's been on it for many years or even many months. Okay, so please be safe. Please go to your physician and see if the doctor will begin to wean you off of those. And that's what they did with Vivian. They could not just stop Vivian's medication immediately. They had to slowly wean her off of that. Now, during that time, she was observed 24/7 that if any time that those other personalities came back, then she would have to be put back on that medication, okay? And so by the grace of God, during this time, she was there for a month and a half. During that time, they weaned her off of, I would say, 99.9% of her medication. And again, she was observed constantly to make sure that she was not going to be get sick, that she was not going to begin having psychiatric problems. And so her body was going through a change. Mentally, she was going through a change. You know, when your body gets used to those types of medications or any type of medication, heart medication, blood pressure medication, cholesterol medication, psychotropic medication, your body is going in opiates, okay? You're going to go through some withdrawal. So they slowly weaned Vivian off of, like I said, 99.9% of these medications. And she did very well. And the reason I truly believe that she did very, very well was because she had people around her that loved her. She felt so very loved. She started to put makeup on. She started to fix her hair differently. Okay? She was becoming the person that God had created her to be and would have been if it wasn't for what she had gone through and experienced. She was a very joyful person, happy person, many hours with her, talking with her, walking around the grounds and such. Just a wonderful person. She thanked me over and over again. Now, there were times when Anna did come out, and that was horrifying. There are some things that Vivian remembers of Anna, and there's other things, by the grace of God, that she doesn't. So after a month and a half of being weaned off of this medication, it was time. Psychiatrists, psychologists got together and decided this is the time for her. And again, Vivian was asked, do you want this exorcism? And Vivian said, yes. During that time, her family was there to visit. They also signed off. And at any given time, that if she would have said no, and then we would have had to stop. But she said yes. She knew what she was going to possibly go through, that it was going to be horrifying, that it was going to be painful, it's going to be sorrowful. And it was. And again, my friends listening, is that the demon, the evil one, just doesn't physically attack us. But emotionally, psychologically, also in our dreams. And the day of the exorcism, we all met in the chapel. Of course, she is not Catholic, and that is fine. But we all met in the chapel together, and we all prayed. Vivian prayed. And after an hour and a half, and then we all went, there were five of us. There were two nurses there that were Catholic nuns, psychiatrist, he was a priest, another psychiatrist, the exorcist. Father Michael was there. I was there. I was there to only assist, only to say the prayers. That's what my job was. And also that Vivian had to trust me, and she trusted me. And if I wasn't in that room, that's one thing that she begged. She begged the priests and the doctors to allow me to be there in the room with her. And I had planned to be in the room also with her, and so did Father Michael. But anyhow, that was her only request. Her only request was that I be in the room with her. And so we all went to the room, and it was in the rectory, which is the home of where the priests live. And it wasn't the same room as Kevin's. It was on a different floor. And again, papers were signed if she needed to be restrained. And then we could do that legally. And that protects the priests, the church, that also protects her, okay? Her family knew what we were going to do. Some of her family members were not in the room, but they were down the hall from us, okay? They are allowed to see her during certain times when we took a break and when Vivian needed to take a break, okay? And so, like I said, and the emergency room at Loyola was put on standby that at any time that if we needed to bring her there, immediately, that a room would be ready for her. Also, that there was psychotropic medication in the room with us if the psychiatrist deemed that it was necessary for her to have that. There was also oxygen, and so we were all set up. There was a crucifix in the room. There were two windows, and the air began to get heavy. The closer that we got to the room, the air got heavy. It was a change. The negativity, the negativity was just overwhelming. Vivian began to cry, and I was holding her hand. She was on a gurney. She was on a cart. I was holding her hand. I said, honey, just take some deep breaths. Okay? Take some great deep breaths. And I said, Vivian, what you're going to go through now, that you may have to relive everything that you've gone through to get rid of this demon. And we have to find out the demon's name. Vivian goes, I don't know what the demon's name is. I said, I know that you don't. I know. That's for us to take care of. That's why Father Michael and these other priests, the psychologists, psychiatrists are here for, okay? But Vivian, you have to do your part. And again, I said, honey, I know it's not going to be easy, but I'm going to be right by your side. If you want to hold my hand, hold it anytime, okay? I'm never going to leave your side. So we get into the room. Vivian's laying on the bed. Vivian is wearing a gown as well as being in surgical clothes, those not sweats, but I can't think of the name now. Goodness gracious. But anyhow, scrubs. Anyhow, so she's wearing a scrub bottom and she is wearing a gown. And so the door is shut. And there's five of us in there. And Father Michael, who is going to lead the exorcism, and another priest. The candles are lit. They sprinkle holy water. They sprinkle holy water on Vivian. And Vivian begins to shake and begins to twist. Her neck becomes very, very, very thick. She begins to speak. Anna begins to speak. And that's the most guttural sound. I will never forget it. Anna began to lash at me and say all sorts of things. And there's some things that I have to, and I realize that I cannot use the words on the radio. Okay, but just think of the most vile words that one can say. The demon was attacking me. The first person that the demon attacked was me, because I'm the one who started all this. And then the demon said that the demon was talking to me, and of course I had to ignore it completely, but being the human being, you want to say something, which I didn't do, but I wanted to. And the demon knew that. And the demon said, I have been inside of this C word. Okay, the demon used the C word, and I know that you know what I'm talking about, Dusta. Okay, anyhow, so the demon started to say, I've been inside of this C for many, many years, and now you have come to interrupt my life. And he said, F you. And again, the priest sprinkled the demon, Vivian, with holy water. She kind of raised off the bed. She did not levitate. I'm not saying that, but she began just to sit up. And then he put her back down softly and gently. And then they started with the prayers, St. Michael the Archangel first, the Lord's Prayer, the Hail Mary, the Litany of the Saints, and the demon started to howl. It was the worst howl that I've ever heard. I thought it was horrible during the exorcism of Kevin, but it didn't even come close to what Vivian was going through. Vivian began to cry, and I was sitting next to Vivian, and I took her hand, and her hand became very, very cold. Very, very cold. And inside the room became cold. Did the windows shake? Yes. Did things rattle? Yes. Did the door flip on? Did the door come open and close on itself? No, it did not. Things began to come off the walls, and Vivian's hand was pressing into mine so badly that it began to hurt me, and Father Michael saw that. So Father Michael came over and removed my hand. Now, during this time, it wasn't Vivian, okay? Not at all. And it was Anna. So the priest, Father Michael, and the other exorcist had to find out what the demon's name was inside, had to do that. And again, we had 48 hours to do this exorcism. And again, it didn't have to be 48 hours straight through, but 48 hours together. That is including break time that we gave. The doctors decided to give Vivian physically a break, okay? Anyhow, so Father Michael came over and removed my hand of where her fingernails had gone into the palm of my hand. But I did not say a thing, but he knew. But I never wanted to leave her. So I was just touching her shoulder. I was rubbing her head. The priest began with the prayers again and asked the demon to come out. I will never forget that. I will never forget Father Michael. And this voice that Father Michael has. Father Michael has this kind of like soft voice when you're just talking to him. But during the exorcism, like with Kevin and now with Vivian, it just boom, very demanding, very commanding voice. And the demon, I need to know your name. Tell me your name. You know, I compel you by the name of Jesus Christ, our Savior, who died for our sins. I compel you, tell me your name. And the most horrendous cackle, the most horrendous laugh. And that's when Vivian began to vomit. It wasn't like in The Exorcist of the movie. It didn't shoot all over the, you know, all over the wall, all over us. It just came from her mouth. And her tongue began to wag like a dog. Her tongue physically, Tessa, physically changed. I have never seen that before in my life. And to see someone's facial affect just change, her tongue changed. I've never seen that. It was like a snake's tongue. It wasn't split, but it was moving like that. And I remember Tessa hearing the sound. It sounded so primal.
Right.
And the stench in that room, Tessa, it was the worst smell. I thought it was bad when Kevin, during his exorcism, and also in Kevin's house. But no, the demon that was inside of Vivian, of Anna, it was just horrifying. the stench. At one point, I had to leave the room because I thought I was going to vomit. I had to leave. And then I stayed out for a while, and then I went back in. But just to seeing what this poor woman was going through, and again, like I said, that it just doesn't affect the person physically, but it's also psychologically. It's also emotionally. And my God, the things that came out of Vivian's mouth about how she was molested, how she was raped, how and what they used on her as a child into her vaginal area. And what they did to her, she was reliving this. The demon was making her relive all of this. Vivian started to cry and beginning to and sob, and you could say, and she was getting to the point where she was becoming so restless that they decided to use soft ties on her. And her heart rate, and so a nun who was a nurse took her blood pressure, and it was getting very, very, very high. And so we decided to stop just briefly. And another nurse gave her some water to drink. And then it continued. And then the exorcism continued. You know, Tessa and people who are listening to this, I wish I could go into more detail of what horrifying, but she was living everything. And all of a sudden she began to talk like a child. It was Anna. Anna began to talk like a child and saying, why are you doing this to me? Not the exorcism, but of how the devil, how the evil one was making Anna relive all this over again, of how she was burned by a hot poker, how she was molested, how she was sodomized, how she was forced to do things that a four-year-old child should never have to undergo. I remember, this very moment, Tessa and everyone, I am back in that room, and that's why I'm so emotional about it, because I saw this woman relive everything that she had gone through as a 4 and 5 year old child. But I knew that is the only way that I could get this damn demon out of her. And after 3 hours, again, the priest, all these prayers, some of the nuns began to chant some Gregorian prayers. And all at once, the demon came through. And I really don't want to say the demon's name, Tessa. It's like a calling card, like I said with Kevin. You know what I mean?
And that's okay. You don't have to.
Okay. And I don't think it's safe to. Okay. But again, let me tell you that you can look on Google, or if you know about the demon's names, it is the nastiest, 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 and vile. Vile, vile, okay? And having Anna, her fractured personality, go over and what she had gone through, it was just palpable. You could feel it in the room. And finally, the demon says its name. And let me tell you that that room was still, was quiet. But let me tell you, but physically, we all felt like the room was going to fall apart. We felt that inside of us when the demon said its name. And the minute the demon said its name, then Father began to put a crucifix on her head, began to sprinkle again her with holy water. And the room and the air in the room became very, 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 even more negative, very much so. Vivian began, her respirations became very fast. And so Father stopped and paused. And this time it was 4 hours. So again, we have the priest had 48 hours. But this woman, this Vivian, this creature of God, our sister in need, was going through so much. She was living what she had put and stuffed inside of her, of what happened to her. She was reliving it. It was when she was 4 and 5 and 6 and 7 and 8. And she was reliving all this. And when, how explicit can I get, Tessa?
When it comes to abuse and stuff, I'd rather not get too deep into it. There's certain things that we're not supposed to talk about on the air, so.
Okay. 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 Just think of when a woman has her first period. Okay? And I will leave it at that. Okay? And Anna was talking about that, talking about what, and again, she was ritually abused. She was ritually abused physically, emotionally, sexually. They used her, gosh, just think of, ladies, think of when you have your period, okay? And just think of the most vile, horrible thing that one could do with that, okay? And magnify that a million times. And that's what Vivian went through. And Anna was, and so Anna was screaming all this, and Vivian's body was reliving this. And again, like I said, that we took a break. And this went on, this exorcism went on and on and on. It wasn't until, I would say probably in the 45th, because we had 48 hours, it wasn't until, I think it's documented in my papers, and those papers, like with Kevin, I put them aside. I think it was about the 45th hour, 46th hour, that the exorcism, it was at its height. And again, the room didn't shake, but think of how one's body would feel like the room was shaking, if that makes sense. And it was the demon trying to mess with us psychologically, okay? Because there was nothing moving in the room, but we felt like it was. Okay? The demon attacked myself. The demon attacked Father Michael. The demon attacked the Catholic nuns that were in there. Okay? But about the 45th or 46th hour of this, and then this stench, like I said, was horrible. It was the worst garbage. It was the worst methane gas. It was the worst outhouse smell that you could think of. It was rotting flesh. Rotting flesh. It smelled like burning flesh. It smelled like sulfur in that room. Horrible, horrible. And the priest began to chant a Gregorian chant, part of the Roman rite of exorcism. More holy water. The priest went over and they put a holy cross on, they put a crucifix on her chest. They put one, and then the priest held another crucifix, which I have, that Father Michael gave me one of the crucifixes during the exorcism of Kevin. He gave me one of those afterwards, and he gave me one after the exorcism of Vivian, and I have both of those. And so there were different crucifixes on her, and more prayers, and the priest, Father Michael's voice boomed and boomed and boomed. I compel you in the name of Jesus Christ, our Savior, who died on the cross for us, to get out of Vivian, to get out of her now. And the room, this time, the room did begin to shake. Things did fly off of the shelves. The chairs were toppled over. The windows quaked. And the And the more that Father Michael became commanding of this evil one to get out of her, the room was shaking even more and more and more. And Tessa and everyone, let me tell you, when you experience that physically, your body goes through so much. And my part of it, again, is to be next to Vivian. And I was, and during one time, and one part of it, that Vivian, it's not Vivian, but the evil one turns Vivian's head and tells me that I'm nothing but a effing loser. And that if I don't do things right, that I am going to be the next one possessed. Could you imagine, Tessa, someone saying that to you, the evil one saying that to you or anyone?
No, that would totally freak me out.
And so the priest, and so Father Michael came over to me and blessed me and put the crucifix on me and told me, goes, Robert, you are protected by the blood of Christ. You are protected by the holy martyrs. You are protected by St. Michael the Archangel. Demon, leave us now. In the name of Jesus Christ, leave now. And I'm getting goosebumps. And just a second or two after that, Vivian's breathing became much better. Okay, so now we're into the 46th, 47th hour. And I remember that Vivian went, she wasn't giving up her last breath, but the demon had left her. Anna now was gone. And Vivian went into this deep sleep. And again, we continued to pray. We did not leave her. We did not leave her for hours after that. And she went into this very deep sleep. They took her blood pressure and it was fine. They took her pulse and it was fine. She had soiled herself. And so the Catholic nuns and nurses that we men left the room, and then the nurses, the nuns cleaned her up, put a new gown on her and scrubs and such. She was untied because, like I said, that she was in soft ties. So they removed the ties from her and she just looked so peaceful. I've never seen Vivian look so peaceful until now, of course. So the exorcism, by the grace of God, through just not of the prayers of the priest, but the prayers of the church and the prayers of Vivian's family and also Vivian's prayers. Vivian had to do most of the work, okay? She had to want this from her completely. She was so used to it. It's just like, if you were a small child and every day you were giving an ice cream cone and then all at once it stopped, your body would be craving that. You know what I mean? Physically and psychologically, okay? And so here for all these years that Vivian went through this, and now she was at peace, totally at peace. She remained in the, she was in that room. The priest came back. I came back in the room after she was cleaned up. We all sat around on chairs. They had brought chairs in to sit around her bed now three nuns were there now. And we all held hands. We held Vivian's hand and each of us began to say a prayer. And so we said many, many prayers. One of the prayers, some of the prayers were in thanksgiving to God that she was, that she became whole again. And that, and we were praising God for his help. We were praising God and thanking God for Vivian's life, for saving Vivian's life. Vivian then, she was in that room another 6 to 8 hours. And then after that, she was removed from that room onto a cart and then wheeled over to the hospital. She was in a private room. There was a nurse practitioner who was a nun that stayed with her. There was also a male seminarian that stayed with her also. I showered. I went down to the chapel. And during that time after that, I needed to process everything. You know, we all did. And so each of us in our own way, we did what we needed to do for ourselves. And then we got back together that evening and talked about what we had just experienced. Now, this was taped, videotaped, and it was sent to Rome to help others learn about exorcism. Okay. Vivian was in the hospital for the next month just to make sure. Okay. Just to make sure. Vivian now, she is back on a light dose of psychotropic medication, but nothing like what she was before. And Tessa and everyone who is listening, she is a different woman. Oh my, what a precious gift from God. And she was a precious gift from God the moment she was born, and the crap that this woman had gone through, and how miraculously that, you know, that she found out, that her family found out about me. You know, it's just, you know, that we have a good God, we have a great God, and that God puts us where we need to be at any given time. You know, some people have called me an angel. I am no angel. I fall short of the glory of God every day of my life, but I try. One of my mottos is that we are all created to serve each other. And that's what I think that's what my position in this life is to assist others in need. And like I said before, that God puts us where we need to be at any given time. Vivian now is home, and she has been home. She is doing wonderfully, beautifully. She remembers some of it, but by the grace of God, she doesn't remember all of it. Her and her family now go to a Bible church. She is a different woman. She truly is. I talk to Vivian a couple times a month. Her family calls me on a regular basis to let me know how she's doing. And I plan to see her very, very soon. And so my brothers and sisters who are listening to this, I could have gone into more detail of what I experienced in that room, of what the evil one said about so many things about her, reliving every filthy thing that people had done to her. Just think of the worst abuse you could think of and multiply that by a million. And maybe you would come close to know what Vivian had gone through as a four-year-old child, beginning when she was four and five, six, seven, eight, 12 years old. So by the grace of God, Vivian is well. She's doing well. She sees her psychiatrist. She sees her psychiatrist once a month. She is into counseling. And that is helping her a lot. And like I said, that we still keep in communication with each other. So I praise God that Vivian's exorcism turned out beautifully for her. I praise God that no one was hurt inside of that room. I praise God for everything in my life. And again, I'm not a Bible thumper or beater, okay? Not at all. It's just a fact that you know, I thank God every day for all the blessings in my life. I pray for so many people. People on Facebook have asked for prayer. I don't say them by name specifically, but several times a day I will ask God to please be with the people who have asked for prayer on Facebook, and for all those in special need, all of those who are being bothered, all of those who are being bothered by the evil ones, that please God be with them. And so that was my experience and my friendship with Vivian. And Vivian is a beautiful soul, beautiful spirit. And I hopefully one day that she will be able to tell what she remembers. But like with Kevin, he's not ready yet. And with Vivian, she is she's not ready yet, also. But in time they will. So I hope everyone, just take care of each other, take care of yourselves. And again, if you need my assistance in anything, please call me at 309-213-0325. And thank you again, Tessa, for everything. I appreciate you so very, very much.
And I appreciate you and all the work that you've done to help not only Kevin and Vivian, but all these little angels that are, taken from us way too soon. And, I know there's a plan for everyone, but it is really hard. And, we're all put here for some reason. It seems like for me, I'm here for a lot of people during their death. Like, I don't know how many people that I've been there for as they took their last breath, but you do that for these little children and help them connect to their angels. And that's just so remarkable and awesome. And I commend you for the work that you do. And I really appreciate you and love your spirit. You're an amazing person.
And you're an amazing person also. And everyone, please have, for the gentleman out there, please have a most wonderful, wonderful, wonderful Father's Day. And for the women out there who had to be both mother and father, you too celebrate today. God bless all of you. And if you need me, please go to my Facebook page. It's a little boy that you see that I helped. I was with in the last moments, well, the last hours of his life. And that little boy's picture is my profile. And send me a friend request. And I will accept it. And again, God bless everyone. Take care of yourself. Take care of each other. And always remember that you are loved. And that all of us need to love ourselves. And we need to accept who we are in life. God bless all of you. Thank you, Tessa. Love you.
I love you too, Robert. And we still have, about 5 more minutes. Is there anything else that you wanted to share or tell our listeners about?
Let me see. I can talk just real quickly about the hospice that I am volunteering at, just briefly, and then maybe if you have the availability in the next couple months or whenever, that I can talk fully about my experience in this hospice. Okay?
That'd be wonderful.
About 6 years ago, some friends of mine who are nurses in a hospice here in Peoria, I'm not allowed to say the hospice name, but they had gone to one of my public events that I did for that little boy whose picture you will see on my Facebook page. And so I did a benefit for that little boy. And we raised like $10,000 for he and his family. But anyhow, people just heard me from there, this hospice did, and they asked me if I would be interested in volunteering. They could not pay me, and I understand that, but if I would volunteer with them. And they minister, their ministry, the hospice ministry, is for children from the age of just a baby until they're 13 years old. Okay, that's the oldest they do, oldest the age. And anyhow, I said, of course I would. And because I knew during this event that I did, this little boy's name was Reed, that's what his name is. And so they knew that I speak to angels, I see angels. And going into many of these homes, their families are just so spent physically and emotionally, and they're their last wits, and they seeing their only child slowly declining, slowly dying in front of them. I am there for the child as well as for their parents. And I go into their room, and some children will say, Robert, what took you so long? and nobody told the child my name. Nobody knew, no, the child did not know that I was coming at all. But by the grace of God, through their angel, they knew that I was coming. And I will sing to the angels. I will talk to the children about angels. Some of the children can speak, and some of them cannot or can't speak. They will talk about angels. They will talk about angels coming towards them, and they ask me if I see them. And I always tell these sweet, precious creatures of God that I am there to take your hand, and the other angel who is coming to you closer will take the other hand. And that angel who is coming, and you see this beautiful angel, you see them, as I can tell by your face because you're smiling, and they'll say yes, so they will nod. And I said, this beautiful angel will take you the rest of the way on your journey to heaven. And usually I'm called in maybe 8 hours before the child leaves this earthly dimension. And again, the youngest child I was with was 3, and the oldest child that I was with has been 11. And all of them are suffering some type of cancer, some type of leukemia, some type of brain cancer. So I'm there for the child to be with them, to escort them, to help them on their transitioning here from this earth to heaven. And there are so many more stories, and I will tell them sometime when I can be back on air, and about the stories that the children will relate to me and what they have experienced. And like I said, I'm also there for their parents to do whatever I need to do to assist them.
That's so awesome that you're able to be there with them, and how amazing that that he knew your name and he had never even heard it. It had to be his angel, yes, or somebody that told him that, you know?
Yes. Oh, yes, very much so. And for both of us to see the same angel. And like I said, some of the children were not able to speak, and so they will point. And even before I say, do you see an angel, they will point. They will point in the corner, or they will point at the ceiling, or they will point, or they will like tap the bed, and they will smile. I'll be sitting on the other side, and it's almost like they are beckoning their angel to come and sit next to them. It's unbelievable. The experiences that I've had with these children is a painful and sorrowful, yes, but just knowing that their grandparents, their great grandparents have come to get them, and mostly that their angel have come to take them home. Beautiful. It is both sad and beautiful at the same time.
Well, Robert, we're at the end of our time. Would you like to give our listeners your number again if they would so choose to call and ask you questions?
Oh, yes. My number is here in Peoria, Central Standard Time, 309-213-0325. Again, 309-213-0325. And everyone have a most blessed night, and have a blessed and wonderful Sunday. Give someone a hug today, and always remember that each life is precious, and that we're all brothers and sisters. Thank you, Tessa. God bless everyone.
Thank you, Robert, so much for being my guest and for joining us on Spaced Out Radio this evening. It was so wonderful having you on the show again.
Thank you, my friend.
And thank you to everyone on Spaced Out Radio, Facebook, Spreaker, Twitter, Periscope, Paranormal Radio, TalkStream Live, and wherever else you're listening in the universe tonight. I had a wonderful time this evening, and it was my pleasure literally and figuratively, and I can't wait to do it again tomorrow night for Spaced Out Radio. From the cliffs, hey, Spaced Out Sundays. We actually have a paranormal group on tomorrow night, and basically a team, so it's going to be pretty awesome, and you can catch that on spacedoutradio.com. You're the perfect girl, we'll crawl for miles through the sand, you'll win your hand and be your man. Don't forget, we're all in this together. Together we can make the world a little better. And together, my friends, we own the night. Until next time, nighty night, love and light to all my space cases out there. You guys have a wonderful rest of your weekend. Happy Father's Day to all the dads out there and to all the moms doing both jobs. You guys take care of my youths. I'll see you back here tomorrow night. Enjoy the rest of your Sunday. Don't forget, you can join us for the after party by going on Skype and looking up Tessa, Thomas-Peterson, or you can call in from Skype 970-335-9596. 970-335-9596.